Okay, so we're discussing about the Gauss Seidel method. Okay, so in the last lecture, we're discussing about Gauss Seidel method. To solve the implicit VTCS scheme. Okay, so Gauss Seidel is an iterative method that we understood, and we also understood that why iterative methods are used as compared to direct methods. Okay, so direct methods are limited only for very small size of the problem, and if the matrices used in the direct methods are very sparse, then direct methods become very time consuming activities and not so generalized things. So iterative methods are used in order to take advantage of the speed, the convergence rate, and the sparsity of the matrix, and also to make the algorithms more generalized to solve any type of problem, and also to make any non-linearity comes into the equations, PDEs, to remove those non-linearities, these iterative techniques gives an additional advantage. So basically in Gauss Seidel, what do we do is, suppose we have a system, say I have a system like 4x1 minus 3x minus 1x3. So I have one system having these equations. So let me write 3x1 minus 5x2 minus 1x3 is equals to 4. Or 2x1 plus 3x2 plus 8x3 is equals to 1. Now suppose this is a system, then what Gauss Seidel method does is, Gauss Seidel method, we convert these equations like x1 will become equals to 5 plus 3x2 plus x3 and 1 divided by 4, like this. Then we calculate x2 from the second equation. This becomes like, so 4 minus 3x1 plus x3, and this we can bring 1/5. Similarly, you can get x3, which will be 1 minus 2x1 minus 3x2, 1/8. Okay. Now, when you are calculating the x1, x2, x3, in the beginning, we assume that here, before calculating this x1, x2, x3, we assume guess values, all guess values, guess values. So we guess x1, so we guess some x1, we guess x2, we guess x3, all variables values are guessed. Okay, and these guessed values, when you are calculating x1, this x2 is this guess value, x3 is this guess value. But when you are calculating x2, x1, this x1 is the latest value. So latest value is this. So x1 is this. But x3 is still not calculated latestly. So it is an old x3. When you are calculating x3, your x1 as well as x2, they are latest. So this is the one and this is the one. You see? So in Gauss-Seidel method, whenever you are calculating these through these equations, these values will be recent values. Okay. There is another method we already said, like Gauss-Jordan. These methods do not use the latest values. So in Gauss-Jordan, suppose this first equation, x1 will be used as 5 plus 3x2 plus x3, x2 equals to minus 1 by 5, 4 minus 3x1 plus x3, and x3 is equals to 1 by 8, 1 minus twice x1 minus 3x2. So in case of Gauss-Jordan, if you assume initially some guess values x1, x2, x3, so these values will be used here, x1 value will be used here, x3 value will be used here, again x1 and x2, there will be these values only, x1 and x2 will be these values. And then in next iteration, in the next iteration, here also there will be next iteration, but I'll just show you here. In the next iteration, what are these values came? Red values. Okay. So those red values become the correct, now updated guess. Over these guess values, these are now the guess values. Now to calculate x1, x1 is equals to 1 by 4, 5, 3x2 plus x3, you use these values. Okay. Similarly for x2, x3. Now, then you will get the values, this blue values. So, these blue values will act as a next guess value, corrected guess value, x2, x3, and to find out new x1, x2, x3, you will use the values. Okay, so you will keep on calculating. So in Gauss-Seidel method, once you calculate x1, x2, x3 with the latest values, then this white values will become the next guess values, x1, x2, x3, and then you will calculate another x1, x2, x3. Okay.
Okay.
Now the same thing happens here when you want to calculate this 3x2 plus x3. So first time these value 3x2, 3x3 will be used here, and whenever the next in this situation 4 minus 3x1 plus x3 here the x1 value is this latest value. Okay, x3 is still old value. So similarly you will get all three values, red values. The next, in next iteration, iteration number, this is first iteration, second iteration, third iteration. Iteration number 3, you will have these new guess values, x1, x2, x3. Then you will calculate x1, x2, another x1, x2, x3 using this principle. So 5, 3, x2. So x2 means this x2 and x3 means this x3, latest value. And here 1 by 5, 4 minus 3 x1. So x1 means this x1 plus x3. X3 means this x3. Similarly, to calculate x3, you have x1 and x2. So these latest values will come here. These latest values will come here to calculate the x3. So we have done iteration number 3. Then again, we'll go for next iteration. So next iteration, in the next iteration, your this green values will become your guess values. And then you will calculate new values of x1, x2, x3 using the same principle, using the latest values in Gauss-Seidel. Now, when to stop? This is iteration number 1, iteration 2, iteration 3, iteration 4. Shall I stop here? Shall I go for 5th? Shall I go for 6th, 7th, 8th and so on? Okay. So that depends upon the differences between these values. Between iteration number n minus 1 and the current iteration. Okay. Or you can say this n. So as per our notations, n minus 1 and n. So if there is difference between x1 n minus x1 n minus 1, if this difference is less than some epsilon, then we stop. If it is greater than some small number, epsilon is a small number like 10 to the power minus 6. So if this is very small, then there is no much difference between x1 values. Similarly, we have to do it for x2, x3. Okay. So if there is no much difference, then we have to stop at this iteration number 4 and get the print the values of x1, x2. So this will be a final result in that case. If not, if x1 n minus x1 n minus 1, this value is not less than very small number, then you have to go for next iteration, iteration number 5. Then again, you have to check whether there is a difference between this fifth iteration or fourth iteration, x1, x2, x3 values. If not, go again sixth, go again seventh, till you get this criteria satisfied. That is how we solve in a Gauss-Seidel method. Now, when you are doing iteration, what is a guarantee? What is a guarantee that in the next iteration, like 3, 4, 5 or any n plus 1th iteration, I'll get this criteria satisfied. Okay. What is a guarantee? Okay. What is a guarantee that? What is a guarantee that? What is a guarantee? That x, I'll just say xm n minus xm n minus 1 will be less than equals to some epsilon. What is the guarantee that? Okay. And if this happens that in the next iteration, so where m is 1, 2, m, and this is nothing but number of variables and n is iteration number. If this happens that in the subsequent iterations, in the subsequent iterations, if this condition happens, so this condition we have to you might have x1 negative or x like that. So you have to see the magnitude. Okay. So then RMS or those criteria are there. So if this happens, that the magnitude mn minus x mn minus 1 happens to be less than a small number, then we say that then we say that the algorithm or iterative method is convergent. Convergent means we are moving towards solution. Okay. If it is not giving this difference, it means that we are not going to get the solution. We are diverging from the solution. So if this is not happening, that the difference between the is not reducing, you can say it should reduce. If you move from one iteration to another, then this difference should reduce. And at some iteration, this difference will become very small number. So it shows that the particular algorithm is showing a convergent behavior. If not, then it is divergent. Okay. So if this is the condition is happening, then we say that iterative method is convergent. Okay. Now, what are the conditions? What are the conditions? What is a guarantee? What gives you a guarantee that a particular method will lead to a solution or will lead to a convergence behavior or convergence? Okay. Convergence means solution. Okay. So it will give you the guarantee that it will lead to convergence behavior. What are these parameters which gives us the guarantee? Okay. That is what we are trying to see here. So what are those? Those depends upon the two parameters. Okay. So number one, it depends upon two things. Okay. Convergence never happens. Sometimes it might be divergent. So convergence is dependent upon number one, the what kind of scheme you are using. Okay. Scheme we are using. Scheme means BTCS, FTCS, this kind of thing. Schemes, forward difference, backward difference. Okay. So a particular scheme will have a particular nature of the coefficient matrix. Okay. Depends upon the scheme used. Second, it is depend upon the matrix. Okay. So matrix A. Like for example, we have seen in the case of illustrate more about scheme used. When we have used the wave equation in those wave equation scenarios, we have seen that the forward difference or backward difference methods has a conditional stability. But central space difference method had no stability limit. It was unconditionally unstable. And those behaviors also affect the convergence. Okay. If your scheme is not stable, you are not going to get the reduction in the residual in the later iterations. So that is the one thing. Also, the nature of the scheme used essentially gives the matrix, okay, coefficient matrix. So nature of this coefficient matrix also affect the convergence. Okay, so now we'll see about the nature of coefficient. Okay, nature of this matrix A. What are the properties of the matrix A need to be satisfied for convergence? Okay, what are the properties? What are the properties need to be satisfied by matrix A? Okay, so say the matrix A looks like this. A11, A12, A13, and you may have another terms here, A1n, A21, A22, A23, and you can have A2n. You can have A2n. You can have A31, A32, A33. Likewise, you can have A3n terms. And here, you can have An1, An2, An3, and finally, you can have ANN. Okay. So, this matrix should be a square matrix, n by n matrix. That is the one thing. But more than that, there is a condition for stability, sufficient condition for stability, which is called as Scarborough criteria. Which is called as Scarborough criteria. Okay. So, one thing is, you should have a positive definite matrix. If you have this Ax equals to B, then the determinant of this A, determinant of A should be equals to 0. Okay, so this is a well-conditioned nature. The second thing is about diagonal dominance. Diagonal dominance. What does this mean by diagonal dominance? Diagonal dominance. So what are the diagonal terms? I'll just make the diagonal terms by red. This is the first diagonal term for this equation. This is a diagonal term for the second equation. This is the diagonal term for the third equation, because x3 was the variable, and this is the diagonal term for the last equation. So these diagonal terms should have a dominance. Okay, should have a dominance over non-diagonal elements. Non-diagonal elements like A12, A13, A1n, A21, A31, A32, A3n. This off diagonal, above diagonal or below diagonal elements, it should have a dominance over those. So that is called as a Scarborough criteria. What it says is that to satisfy a criteria, CRI. Okay. What it says is, an iterative scheme will converse if the matrix A is iterative method, iterative method will converse if matrix A is diagonally dominant, is diagonally dominant. Okay, dominant. NND. Okay, so what does this diagonal dominant means? The diagonal element should. So, for example, the magnitude. Okay, so important thing is magnitude, whether it can be a minus or minus 10 or say we have negative 10 and this is 1, 2, like this we have some numbers in between, all are zeros, suppose, and last one is 1 again. Okay, so if this is the case, now, in this case, what it is saying is that magnitude of AII. So, magnitude of this A central coefficient should be always greater than equals to sum of magnitudes of Aij. Okay. Where J starts from 1 to n, but I should not be equals to J. Okay. If I is equals to J, then you get a II case. So, what does it mean? That the sum of these terms A11, A12, A13, A1n should be less than A11. So magnitude of A11, magnitude of A11 is magnitude of A11. For example, this case magnitude of A1 is 10, and which is greater than sum of A11 like 1 plus 2, and we have all zeros in between. And then last term 1. So 1, 2, 1, 3, 4. So, okay, so it's greater than 4. So that should be the condition. Suppose you go here, in this case, this A22, magnitude of A22 should be greater than sum of A21, A23, A2n. Magnitude of A33, magnitude of A33, when I is equals to 3, I is equals to 3. Okay. In those case, your A31 plus A32 plus A3n, all these terms, including in between terms, those should be less than A33. Similarly, ANn, this value should be greater than the sum of the rest of the values. That is what it says. If that is happening, then your iterative method will converge. Okay, your iterative method will converge. And there is another condition, and for at least one row, for at least one row. Okay, what it first condition is saying about greater than equal to. Okay, sometimes it may happen that for A22, for example, A22, you might get 10 greater than equal to 10. So that is equal to condition is satisfied. But if it is happening for all the rows, first rows also 10 some value, First let me write this. Okay, for at least one row you should have Aii, magnitude of Aii should be greater than the sum of Aij of that row J1 and I not equals to J running to N. Okay, what this mean? So I'll just try to show you here just by writing one matrix. Suppose we have a matrix of this nature. We have 4, 2, and Now in this case, suppose this is a matrix, then in this case this value in this case, this value, this is your A11, this condition A11 0 0, this, so A12 plus A13, that we are checking magnitude of this. So here you see, what do you see from the first case? A11 is equals to sum of A12 plus A13. Here in this case, A22 is equals to again sum of A21 plus A23. Here also we are getting A33 is equals to A31 plus A32. So this is a diagonally dominant system. So iterative method will converge, but at least for one row, it should be greater than the other elements. The second condition is not satisfied here. This condition is not satisfied by this matrix, because here everywhere there is a equal to. Okay, diagonal dominance is there, no doubt. There is a diagonal dominance. All diagonal elements, 11, 8, 8 is greater than 4, 4. Sum of 4, 4. 9 is, dominant. 9 is a higher value than 4, higher value than 5. 7 is a higher value than 3 and 4. And their sum is equals to 8. Sum is 5, 4, sum is 9. 4, 3, sum is 7. Though they are diagonally dominant, this may or may not give, because second criteria is not satisfied. Everywhere there is no greater thing. So suppose this system, now we change this system to another system where we say that there is at least one row where we get diagonal dominance. So now in this case, 82 is greater than A21, A23. So this first criteria is satisfied. Also, second criteria is also satisfied. Then this particular system ensures you that you are going to get the convergence. That is what Scarborough criteria is. Scarborough criteria is this and this, both the things. Okay. It says that iterative method will converge if A is diagonal dominant, which means that Aii diagonal terms are higher in magnitude compared to others, or equal to, but for at least one row, this diagonal magnitude of the diagonal element should be greater than the rest of the sum of the rest of the elements. If that is the thing, then we can get a convergence. So we are ensured that we can get a convergence. Okay. Now, when you are talking about steady state problem, I hope this is understood. So when you are talking about steady state problem in fluid mechanics and heat transfer, this steady state problem, elliptical problems, okay, and most of the heat transfer problems, it is found that we get diagonally dominant matrices. Okay. So, in case of the steady state problem, and even in fluid mechanics, means without convection. If there is only diffusion, then that is fine. Without convection, this particular matrix is always diagonally dominant. Okay. If not, when there is a convection means U del T del X terms is coming, or U del U del X terms are coming, then this convection terms, if they are there, then these lead to something called as convergence difficulty. Okay. Now, if this is the case happening in heat transfer, we may not have to worry. We can get the answers. We can directly, straightforwardly get the answers. Okay. And our life is simple. But if the convection problems are there, like in case of Navier-Stokes equations, if one is solving full Navier-Stokes equations, then we are going to get these convection terms. Then the question is, how to remove convergence difficulty? How to remove convergence difficulty. Okay. Second question also arises, not only in solving convection dominated problem or any problem, is that how to achieve convergence fastly. Okay. Fastly. We want the convergence to happen, but also we want that convergence to happen within some very short time. That is the reason we are using Gauss-Seidel method over Gauss-Jordan method. Suppose we have a Gauss-Seidel method and we have a Gauss-Jordan method. Suppose Gauss-Seidel method is taking n number of iterations to converge. Gauss-Jordan method will take through n times of iteration to converge the same result. So you see, here there is a saving of time, and here there is no saving of time. So suppose we have chosen Gauss-Seidel, even how I can make this n, you know, small? That is a question. How I can make this n small, so that within Gauss-Seidel, I can achieve this convergence fastly. And if there is some convergence difficulty arises, then how I can remove this convergence difficulty? Okay. So, what is the solution? And what is the probable area for solution? Now, what we learn is that Scarborough criteria. So, everywhere now we learn that diagonal dominance should be there. So, one possible solution for reducing the convergence difficulty is to look at the diagonal terms. Look at the diagonal terms. Similarly, to achieve convergence fastly, again, we have to look at the diagonal terms. Okay, so we have some answer. Now, how I can play with this matrix, my original matrix, how I can play with this matrix such a way that Scarborough criteria is satisfied and I achieve the, I remove the convergence difficulty so that Scarborough criteria is, and it becomes fast also. So that is what the next objective should be. Okay. So what we can do, suppose I take this system. Now, suppose I am taking this system, this particular matrix system, and I play with this. So to play with that, what I am doing is, I am taking some number, which is going to divide this, some number called as omega, which is going to divide this, okay, A11, okay. Also, all diagonal elements, so I am going to take some new variable, omega. Here also omega, here also divided by omega, okay. That is only the possibility to play with this diagonal elements. Then only we can remove the convergence difficulty if it is arise, or if it is, it is to be made fast. Okay. So this omega can be greater than one. Okay. Or omega can be less than one. That is also possibility. If omega is greater than one, then diagonal dominance A11, suppose A is 10 and you are dividing by 2, then A, actually this value will become 5. Its magnitude is getting decreased. Okay. So this is called as over-relaxation. Relaxation. We wanted to relax, but we have done something over. We wanted to help, but we did such a help that it become a curse for it. But that has an advantage. That is called as over-relaxation. Over-relaxation. And the second condition, when you consider this value, small value, if you divide any value by the small value, its magnitude is going to increase. So this is called as under-relaxation. Okay. Now, when this particular scheme is used, what is happening? A11 by omega is going to increase from its previous. This A11 will be greater than A11 by omega will be greater than A11. Okay. Now, what is happening? We are increasing the dominance. And such a kind of schemes, or when you use omegas lesser than one, then we are increasing the diagonal dominance. And since we are increasing the diagonal dominance, we are increasing more convergence behavior. Okay, so in case if you find that key after first iteration, second iteration, after few iterations, fourth and fifth iteration, there is no convergence. So values x4 value and x5 value, they are now differing, they are increasing. So in that case, what you can do is you can use this omega which is smaller than 1, and you can increase the dominance of the matrix such a way that if you find that it is diverging, then you can make it converging. Okay, by using omega value less than 1. And suppose you use this omega condition, in that case, what happens is that A11 will be always greater than A11 omega. What is the advantage of this? What is the advantage of this? What is the advantage of this? What could be the advantage? Now we have removed the diagonal dominance. This particular thing is used to increase the convergence rate. Okay. If you find that a particular matrix A11 is highly dominant in terms of diagonal dominance, then this A11 value is such a high compared to any other elements. Then suppose this is A11 is 100, A11 is suppose 1000, for example, and rest of the values are like 1, 2, 0.5 and like that, and 0.5. Okay, so in some of these, all other element is very, very, small compared to this. So what we can do is, rather than having this, you can divide this and play with this. And rather than taking 500, 1000, you can use 500. By doing this, you are actually accelerating the convergence. Okay, so you are reducing the number of iterations. The number of iterations are reduced. This is called an acceleration. Acceleration of the iteration. Acceleration of iterative method. Okay. So over relaxation is used to accelerate the scheme. Under relaxation is used to remove the convergence difficulty. Okay. Then what is the value of omega? We said that it is either less than 1 or it is greater than 1. Then what is the value? Is it in this case, suppose, is it 0.5? Or is it in this case 2, 20, 100? What is the value? What is this value? What is this value for which we get no convergence difficulty? Convergence difficulty is completely removed from one iteration to another iteration or for throughout the case. Or secondly, what values of omega for which you get a good acceleration, minimum time to converse. Okay. So these values are dependent upon matrix, type of the matrix. So it depends upon the problem to problem, and it depends upon the scheme. It depends upon the scheme used and the matrix. So these values of omega are called as omega optimal. So at what this omega optimal are the values for which we get good convergence behavior, very good lesser number of iterations, or very good acceleration. So these optimum values are dependent upon A and scheme. So there is no unique value of omega. It can be less than 1. It can be greater than 1. But what is the value? Is it 0.5? It is 0.2? Is it 0.1? These values are not unique. It depends upon the system. So whosoever is solving their problem, he cannot tell what is my omega optimum. But you can find it out, but that is what done through it trial and error. That is called a trial and error in Fluent. For example, in commercial software, you want to find out omega optimal. You just enter some value, let's say 0.5, and see whether it is convergence behavior is increased or not. Use some value to see whether it is accelerating or not. Okay. You cannot give simultaneously. It depends whether if the particular is not converging, then use omega optimal less than. If problem is to accelerate it, then use this one. So trial and error. But suppose I know some small system, for example, the case like ours, where we took BTCS method. In the BTCS method, what we have seen is that the A11 omega, A11 was in our BTCS, AII or A11 was, what was our central element? A11 was 1 plus twice gamma x and twice gamma y, right? So we want to divide by omega. Okay, now this is there. And summation of Aij, magnitude. Here also you say magnitude. Summation of Aij, what were our Aijs? There was minus gamma x, and then your central element, some zero here, then gamma x, zero, minus gamma x, like that. Isn't it? So essentially you have two gamma x plus two gamma y. This was the case. Now what is the Scarborough criteria says? This should be this should be greater than equals to this value. So that condition we will see A11 magnitude AII should be greater than 1 plus twice gamma x, should be greater than summation magnitude Aij, where j is varying, I is also varying, but I should not be equal to j. That is the case. Okay, so in this case, 1 plus, you substitute this here, you substitute this here, 1 plus twice gamma x plus twice gamma y divided by omega should be greater than twice gamma x plus twice gamma y. This gives you a condition for omega. So omega should be less than 1 plus 1 divided by twice gamma x plus twice gamma y. Now we know that what is gamma x and what is gamma y. Gamma x was our alpha delta t delta x square, and this was alpha delta t delta y square. So these are known values, these are known values, these are known values. So we can find out omega optimum. This is omega optimum, can be find out. This is omega optimum essentially. So we can get a number. If you know this, suppose this value is some number, say 1. This value is say 1. Then we get 1 plus 1 divided by 2 plus 2. So this will be 1 plus 1 by 4. So this will be 5 by 4. So omega optimal value you can get from the condition for a particular matrix. Okay. So this is the way you have to.
Sir, omega optimal can be less than 1 also, sir.
Yeah, that is what I told. There are two conditions. Omega can be less than 1, omega can be greater than 1. So in this particular case, we observe that optimal value is, this is, now in this case, we need to, it is greater than 1. It means that it is to be used for acceleration. So there is acceleration happening. Acceleration is needed. If it is less than 1 value is coming, it means that it is to be used to accelerate it. So for that particular matrix, you might need acceleration or you might need to remove the convergence difficulty. That is what it means. Okay. So for a particular method, you can find out like that. Okay. So it all depends upon, now in this case, this is coming, you know, like 1 point something or something. So it depends upon these values, omega, gamma x and this thing. Okay. So if some cases gamma x may be different, delta t may be different or something, then this term can be, you know, go differently and you might get, you know, some different values. So that is possible. So you have to remember omega is coming less than 1 means it is the under relaxation and over relaxation when omega is coming greater than 1. Okay. And these are used always in any fluent software, these relaxation parameters. They are called relaxation parameters. So in order to accelerate the scheme or to remove the convergence difficulty. And we have seen how these basic properties are associated with the matrix. So please remember these things. I'll stop the class here. Thank you.